Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship on this first Sunday of Advent. A few announcements about life together here at All Saints. As we head into this season of Advent, just a note that on the fourth Sunday of Advent, Sunday, December 17th, we will celebrate with a special music Sunday, and so hope you will make it a point to be here for that day as our musicians here offer us a special service that day. And then a reminder that on Christmas Eve, which is a Sunday, we will gather for worship only at 5 p.m. that evening. There will be no Sunday morning service on Christmas Eve. This week, you are invited to join us for Pub Theology. We will gather at the Thirsty Goat on Tuesday at 6 p.m. People come and either have just something to drink or a snack or dinner, and we share in conversation about what God is up to in the world and what it all means for us anyway. And so if you are interested in joining us for that, we invite you to sign up just so that we have an idea of how many people are coming. There's a sign-up sheet just outside my office. But don't stay away just because you haven't signed up. You are welcome to come whether you're signed up or not. And so we hope to see you Tuesday night at the Thirsty Goat. A reminder that if you have been working on Christmas cards for those in the Madison, in the Dane County Jail, those are due today. And so you're invited to, hopefully if you were working on them at home, you brought them with you today. If you still would like a chance to write in some, there are some blank cards on the high table out in the narthex. You're welcome to take some time during our fellowship time following worship to write a couple of cards. There are instructions for those cards inside. But again, those are due today to make sure that they can get distributed on time. Next Sunday, December 3rd, we will be celebrating Intergenerational Sunday School. So we invite you all to stick around after worship next Sunday as we focus on the gifts of this season and prepare some gifts ourselves for those in need. And so invite you to join us following worship next Sunday for that down in the fellowship hall. Part of what we will be doing, we have a variety of things that we're planning on for next Sunday, but one of those things will be compiling our young adult care kits that we send to those who have recently graduated from high school, wherever they may be in their lives, whether they are working or in college, to encourage them during this holiday season. And so if you would like to help with that, you're invited to bring snacks or gum or hot cocoa or whatever, and there is a tub down in the fellowship hall for those donations. We also are writing notes of encouragement to those young people, and there's a table set up down in the fellowship hall where you can do that today as well as next Sunday. And so you will be a part of that as well. I now invite you to stand as you are able as we begin with our Advent candle lighting and litany.
Grant unshakable confidence in your service.
justice and mercy to ring.
Grant the glimpse of your glory in our wounded world.
For all of us waiting for God's kingdom to come.
Grant that we might have the peace of Christ as we wait, the love of Christ as we act, and the grace of Christ as we seek.
This morning we light the first candle that reminds us that throughout history, God's people have spent time waiting, wandering, and wondering about God's eternal plan. Like the people of old, we long for God's presence to illuminate the areas of life where we are called to wait. This morning, we echo the words of the psalmist, "Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord."
First reading is from Isaiah 64, beginning with the first verse, and it can be found on page 606 of your chair Bibles. A reading from Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when the fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. You are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning with the third verse, and that is found on page 926 of your chair Bible. A reading from 1 Corinthians. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift, as you waited for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Then he will send out the angels
and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree it learned its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn. Or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all. Keep awake. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Have you ever been so worried that you can't sleep? The what ifs and the possibilities keep running through your mind so swiftly that you can't turn your brain off long enough to fall asleep. Maybe you're spending that time worrying, or maybe you are trying to come up with solutions and answers, but either way, you are being kept awake. Or maybe it's not worry that has kept you awake, but excitement. So excited about something that you can't sleep. Maybe it was this past week as families were gathering for the holidays. Maybe it was a vacation, or maybe a celebration of your birthday or of Christmas. The expectation and the excitement have you so wired that sleep is the furthest thing from your mind. A friend of mine once shared with me that she often had a difficult time on her first day of vacation because she was always so excited the night before that she couldn't get any sleep. So that first day of vacation, she was super tired. Her excitement was keeping her awake. As I reflected on that, I realized that while I don't normally have trouble sleeping for either of those reasons, I'm probably more of the losing sleep because of worry person, because I miss out on sleep the night before vacation, because I'm wondering if I'll oversleep, or because I have forgotten to pack something. And so that worry is what keeps me awake those nights rather than the excitement, no matter how excited I might be. Today, we begin this season of Advent, and it is a time of waiting, a time of eager anticipation. But we aren't just waiting to celebrate the birth of Jesus, something that happened a couple thousand years ago. We're also waiting for Jesus to come again, just as he promised he would. Waiting for Christmas to be celebrated probably brings about that excitement more than it does worry. Although there are several things that can make the holidays stressful too. But in the big picture, even those of us who struggle with the holidays know that we'll make it through and we'll get a fresh start when it's over. But Jesus fulfilling his promise to come again may have us feeling all of those emotions at the same time. When we really think about that promise, when we prepare for that eventual reality, we're likely both excited and a little worried, especially when we hear Jesus talk about that day in our gospel for today. But while it might sound a bit worrying, I think it is more of an invitation for us to be paying attention. In the words of pastor and writer Laura Winner, Jesus longs for us to be filled with expectation, so excited about his return that we couldn't sleep even if we wanted to. And while we don't know the day or the hour, Jesus does invite us to stay awake. Not necessarily in a way that causes us to lose sleep, but to pay attention to all of the ways, big and small, that he comes to us. Not just when he comes again in glory, but the ways that he comes to us each and every day. As you may know or may have heard me talk about in the past, we start each confirmation class by sharing our highs and lows and God moments for the past week. A God moment is that moment in our week when we felt closest to God, when we were most aware of God's presence with us. It's an amazing practice, in part because it is wonderful to hear the variety of ways that young people are experiencing God in their daily lives, but also because I happen to know from experience that the more you start watching for God in your daily life, more often you will be aware of the Holy One's presence in each and every moment. Actually, it started this practice several years ago in my previous congregation. As Lent approached and we would be taking several weeks off from our regular Wednesday night confirmation program due to our midweek services, my co-teacher and I were working on some kind of project for the students to work on during that time we would be apart. And so we asked them to watch for God and then come back and report to us what they had experienced. That very first time that we had these seventh and eighth graders share those experiences was a powerful evening as they shared pictures of trips they had taken, sunsets whose beauty had stopped them in their tracks, their favorite sports team winning an important game, and mountains that made them stand in awe of our Creator, along with opportunities to serve those less fortunate than they were. So when one student, whom I knew had a little sister, started his report by sharing that he loved being an only child, I was a bit concerned about where we were headed. He had a PowerPoint presentation and everything, and he laid it on thick, all of the reasons why being an only child was so wonderful. And he shared his disappointment when, at 12 years old, he found out he wasn't going to be an only child anymore. A younger sibling was on the way, and he was not at all happy about it. Just as I was getting worried that he had missed the point of the assignment, the next picture popped up on the screen, a picture of his adorable, smiling little sister. And he shared how his attitude completely changed when he looked in her eyes, when he saw her smile, when she, who was at the time now 3, would run to greet him when he came home from school. It wasn't just that his opinion about being an only child had changed. He shared that this little sister was the most powerful way that he had experienced God. Her unconditional love of him helped him to understand God's love for him as well. This young man was able to welcome Jesus into each day of his life through the love and the life of his little sister. And that is the most basic thing that we can each do to live fully into this season of Advent, to stay awake to the many and various ways that Jesus shows up in our lives on a regular basis, not necessarily in flashy ways, and sometimes in the most unexpected of people. Lauren Winner tells a story of a friend of hers who has a basic life principle that she will invite into her home anyone who knocks on her door. Her friend Sarah, who also happens to be a Baptist pastor, has in this way entertained a variety of interesting people, including a couple of weeks in a row as she sat and chatted with Jehovah's Witnesses for a couple of hours. But perhaps the most interesting of these visits happened with a door-to-door vacuum salesman, if you can believe that those folks still exist in our world today. When the salesman knocked on her door, she let him know that he was welcome to come in for coffee, but she wouldn't be buying a vacuum. And she wasn't even going to let him do his demonstration because her kids were napping. Even though she wouldn't be buying anything or allowing him to even demonstrate his product, he agreed to come in for a cup of coffee. As they chatted, the salesman asked Sarah why she invited him in if she was certain she wasn't going to buy anything. And this was her reply. I'm inviting you in because I worship a God who has told us that he may be found in any person, any neighbor, any stranger, anyone who might turn up on our doorstep, anyone we might meet out in the world. So I'm offering you coffee because I think you might be Jesus. What a powerful way to look at the world. And while inviting into your home everyone who knocks on your door might not be how you want to approach this, I do think that we could learn from her and take the steps we can to be more alert to the ways that Jesus is present in our lives. And maybe most importantly, the people through whom Jesus is present in our lives. You could try welcoming Jesus as you find him in your coworker, maybe even the coworker you struggle to get along with, or in that person who is holding up the line at the store. Invite yourself to be more aware of the Jesus you encounter in the people around you. When we continue to see the ways that Jesus appears to us each day, even in unexpected ways and through unexpected people, that excitement will grow and the worry will melt away, filling us with nothing but anxious anticipation for Jesus to come again. Keep awake. Amen.
Thank you.
Especially those who serve as missionaries near and far. Center us on your promise to come among us and make all things new. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
All creation signals your presence, O God. The vastness of the cosmos, the turn of the seasons, and living things that both rest and flourish. Rekindle our commitment to care for the earth. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Let the nations tremble at your holy presence, that justice and liberation prevail in all corners of the earth. Restore peace to nations in conflict. Teach righteousness to corrupt leaders and systems, and bring stability to areas facing uncertain futures. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Enrich the spirits of all who feel hopeless, fearful, or despairing. Stay close to those who await healing or relief, especially Chris, Nate, Bev, Kurt, Daryl, Madison, Abby, Michael, Mike, John, and those we name before you now, aloud or silently. Deliver all in any need. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Be with those who keep awake at night, nurses working overnight shifts, caregivers of newborns and aging adults, stargazers, those who are anxious, or those who are traveling. Reveal to all that the dark can be a place of calm and comfort filled with your presence. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You have sent out your angels and gathered your faithful people from every time and place, calling them into one fellowship of saints. Bless the witness of those who dwell in your eternal presence. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Listen to these and all our prayers, O God of hosts, and restore us with your great and everlasting mercy. And all God's people say,
Amen.
You may be seated, and I invite any children to come up and join me for the children's message. Good morning. How are you this morning? Good. Just you and me today, huh? Yeah. So I have a question for you. Do you have a routine that you are in to get ready in the morning to go to school or to come to church? Yeah. What are some of the things that you do in the morning to get ready?
First of all, my mom wakes me up early, which honestly, and then I go take a bath, and then I for my school routine, my mom wakes me up, and then I go to the bathroom, and then I take a bath, and then I wash my teeth after, and then I put my clothes on, and then I eat breakfast, and I didn't just watch TV until it's time to go to school.
All right, so your mom wakes you up. You have a bathroom.
I just wash my teeth first, then I go to the bathroom, and then I put my clothes on.
All right. So do you ever do things in a different order?
Yep.
Yeah? Do you get messed up if you do that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
One time I took a bath first, and then doing church, and then I wash my teeth.
Yeah, I think sometimes when I do that, I have a routine for getting ready too, and sometimes if I do stuff out of order, I'm walking out of the house and I realize that I forgot to do something. If I don't brush my teeth when I'm used to brushing my teeth, sometimes I'm starting to walk out of the house and I realize I forgot to brush my teeth and I have to go back and do it. Does that ever happen to you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we get in these patterns, don't we, to prepare to go to school. Why do you think you do all that stuff before you go to school?
Because you can't go to school naked.
You can't go to school naked. That is a good point. Yeah, that would not be good, would it?
Yeah.
But you eat some breakfast, you got some sleep the night before, you do all of those things so that you're ready for school, right?
Yeah.
What if you never went to sleep the night before and you had to go to school? Would you be ready for school the next day?
I'd be ready.
You'd be ready without any sleep the night before?
Yeah.
You think you'd make it through the whole day and not fall asleep in class?
Yeah, make it through the whole day.
You would? I'm impressed. I'm not sure I could do that. If I missed a night of sleep, I'm not sure I would stay awake at my desk all day. You think you could, though, huh?
Yeah.
You think if you didn't eat breakfast before you went to school, would you be able to concentrate as well?
At school, we usually serve breakfast.
You have school at breakfast?
We have school breakfast.
All right. So if you didn't get breakfast at home, you could get it at school?
Yeah.
Yeah. But we do those things so that we can be paying attention, right?
Yeah.
So if you didn't have breakfast at all, you might not be able to concentrate as well. If you didn't get as much sleep as you needed, you might not be able to concentrate.
If I didn't eat breakfast, I would survive the entire day.
You'd survive the entire day without breakfast?
Yeah.
Do you think you'd be able to concentrate as well, though?
Yeah.
Yeah? Yes. You don't need breakfast to concentrate?
Yeah.
So we do all these different things to kind of prepare ourselves for our day, though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah? So in the church, we have this season of Advent that is preparing us too. What do you think we're preparing for this month?
Advent,
right? We're in the season of Advent. Advent is a season that we take time to prepare. What are we preparing for? What comes after Advent?
Christmas,
right? So we're preparing for Christmas. Have you started Christmas preparations at your house?
We haven't even set up the Christmas tree.
You haven't set up your Christmas tree yet? We haven't either, but we did go get our Christmas tree yesterday.
My mom already bought my Christmas tree. I bought the Christmas tree like last year.
Your mom bought the Christmas tree last year?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we do all these different things to prepare for Christmas. But it's not just Christmas that we're preparing for either, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, so you set up the Christmas tree.
We did set up the Christmas tree. And we have the Advent wreath up, and everything is blue in here. So we did a whole bunch of changes to kind of prepare. But it's not just Christmas that we're preparing for. We're preparing to welcome somebody. Who are we preparing to welcome? Jesus, right?
Yeah.
So it's not just that we're preparing to have a celebration of Jesus being born, but we're preparing to, we're preparing our hearts, we're preparing our lives to make sure that we welcome Jesus, that we're ready to welcome Jesus. How do you think we might do that?
Pray.
Pray? Yeah. If we pray, and if we look for Jesus, right? Because Jesus is with us all the time, right? Yeah. And so if we keep watching for Jesus, we will see Jesus everywhere we go. Because Jesus is with us all the time.
I thought he was Santa.
You thought he was Santa? Sometimes we mix those things up at Christmas time, don't we? Because we get both of those messages at Christmas time.
Yeah.
But next week, we're going to talk about the gifts that Jesus brings us at Christmas in Sunday school. So I hope you'll stick around for that.
Yeah.
All right?
Yeah.
Yeah? It'll be one of the ways that we prepare to welcome Jesus. So can you work on that with me this month? Can you be more aware of seeing Jesus in your life every day?
Yeah.
Yeah? Maybe you and your family can talk about that at dinner. You can all share how you saw Jesus that day. You think that would be a good practice this
Advent? I usually eat dinner by myself.
Do you?
Yeah.
So maybe at night before you go to bed, I'm guessing that you're not home all by yourself all night long, right? Yeah. So sometime in the evening, you're with some of your family, right?
I'm usually with my mom when I go to sleep.
You're with your mom when you go to sleep? But that could maybe, or maybe, after, do you have breakfast with your family?
No.
No? You have breakfast by yourself too?
Yeah.
Yeah. But sometime during the day, you can talk about how you're seeing Jesus. You think you might be able to do that?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right. You think all those guys could maybe try that too?
Some of them?
I think it would be great if we all tried that, don't you think?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right. Will you pray with me? All right. Dear Jesus, we ask you to be with us as we prepare again for you to come to us. Help us to see you in each and every day of our lives. In your name we pray. Amen. Will you help me share the peace?
Yeah.
All right. Are you doing nice and loud?
Yeah.
All right. You ready?
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share signs of peace with one another.
God's peace.
Thank you.
invite you to stand as you are able as we join together in our offertory prayer. Let us pray. God of light, our world is a very dark place. Therefore, we offer the gifts of ourselves, our time, and our resources, trusting you will use them to set the world aglow with your divine presence. May we continue to shine brightly before others, so they may see our good works and give glory to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. And we look for hope, we look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us, bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light, bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. And all God's people say,
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
In this meal, righteousness and peace meet together. Come, take your place at the table, where all are welcome. May be seated.
Thank you.
and all God's people say,
Amen.
Let us pray. Generous God, in this bread and cup you have revealed your glory for all people to see together. Nourished by this meal, send us out to proclaim your good news of liberation and release, brought to birth in Jesus Christ our Savior. And all God's people say,
Amen.
The God of peace bless you, the love of Christ sustain you, and the anointing of the Holy Spirit remain upon you now and forever. And all God's people say,
Amen.